Today is April 12, 1998. We are interviewing Morris Rosnow, born Moshe Rosnow. My name is Ruth Durling. We are in Walnut Creek, California, in the United States of America, and the language is English. Today is April 12, 1998. We are interviewing Morris Rosnow, born Moshe Rosnow. My name is Ruth Durling. We are in Walnut Creek, California, in the United States of America, and the language is English. Please begin by stating your full name now and your full name at birth.
My name is now is Morris Rosnow, R-O-S-N-O-W. At birth it was Moshe Rosnow, R-A-Z-N-O-V.
And where were you born?
I was born in a small town in the eastern part of Poland called Rzetel in Yiddish. Now it's part of Belarus, the Republic of Belarus. When I was born, it was part of Poland.
What was the name of the town when you were born?
The name is, in Yiddish, they call it Rzetel, but in Polish it was Jęczol. In Russian, it's Dziatlovo. But in Yiddish, a Jewish person would know it as Rzetel.
What is your date of birth?
January 7, 1927.
Who were your parents?
My parents, my father was Chaim Michal Rosnow, and my mother was Hanna Rashka Rosnow.
What was her maiden name?
Rabinovich.
Where were your parents from?
Well, they were from Rzetel. I'm sure they were. Maybe if they were not born in Rzetel, they were born in a small community around Rzetel, but that's from the area. Yeah, they were from Rzetel.
How many children did they have?
Three children. I have two sisters and myself.
What are the names of your sisters?
One of my sisters' name is Sarah, and my older sister's name is Mira. I'm the youngest from the siblings.
Did you have any cousins while you were growing up?
Oh yeah, I had cousins. There was one, my uncle, my father's sister, she was married to a gentleman by the name of Hirschel Benjaminovich. And they had three children. We were very close in age, and we were got along very well. And I have another cousin in Vilno, on my mother's side. And he was about my age, and that's about all the cousins.
How far is Vilno from your hometown?
Vilno is about 150 kilometers in the north of my hometown. Now it's the capital of Lithuania. And my cousin is not there anymore.
Describe Rzetel as you remember it as a child.
I was very happy in Rzetel. It's a small town. It has several streets. In my memory, it had everything anybody could need. It was in Rzetel. The center point of Rzetel was a marketplace, and there was a church. It was called Kostel, a Catholic church. And the marketplace had some stores on one side, the professional people on the other side. It was not big, but it was more than a street. Let's see, what exactly, this is geographically, that's Rzetel. It's about, we didn't have any, the transportation from Rzetel was there was a railway station called Novoyelnya. It was about 10 kilometers from Zhytel. And if you want to go someplace, you had to go there. Either you walk or you take a, there was a shuttle service. There was an automobile. But a lot of people walked, including me. And from there you could get a connection by train to go any place you want. Most of the people in Zhytel, I was going to elementary school, which was a Yiddish speaking school. It was called Yiddish Volksschule, and Shalom Aleichem Yiddish Volksschule. And that was my life. I had a lot of friends. I had a lot of people. I had a loving family. I had a very happy childhood. I remember being very happy. A lot of friends. In our family, my father was an insurance salesman. Fire insurance and also life insurance, but nobody, I don't think he had any life insurance policies, but fire insurance, yes. And we also had a small five intensive store, very small, and but together we made a pretty good life.
What sorts of things did your father sell in the store?
Oh, buttons, needles. It was cotton, sweaters. I think that's about. We didn't have any pants or anything, suits or anything like that. It was difficult. To manage the store was difficult because we didn't have enough money to pay for all the merchandise, so we had to borrow from one person and then borrow somebody else to pay this person and then borrow somebody else to pay the other person. It was a continuous struggle. And my mother used to hate it to have to go and already knew, you know, you go to the same people because they are the ones that have the money. Well, but we survived, we functioned, and it was a very good feelings about my childhood. when I came home, my grandmother was always home. My maternal grandmother, she was always feeding me.
What did she feed you?
Oh, because when we came home, it's about 2 o'clock, I guess. So we eat the main meal.
What would be in the main meal?
Mainly potatoes, beef, bread. Not that much, not vegetables. But anyway, the vegetables are all cooked. And I think that's about what we ate. Occasionally we buy some fruit in season. Apples, you had to wait for September or something like that to get apples. Because otherwise it was very expensive and you couldn't afford it. But it wasn't even available for all year round. And I don't remember being hungry. So it was a comfortable life.
Was your family religiously observant?
Not that much. I think my father was more observant earlier in his life, but we did celebrate the holidays. and we Shabbat for Shabbat. But we were not. I never went to a cheder because my father didn't somehow turned off the religious part of Judaism. He was more involved in the Bund. Like he was more involved in socialism. He really felt that socialism is the best would be the best for the Jewish people in my hometown.
How many Jews lived in Jetel?
I think about 3,500 out of a population of close to 5,000, which was a high percentage. And so it was a Jewish town. The language the Jews spoke was Yiddish. If you knew Yiddish, you could travel in that part of Poland when I was a child and get along very well because everybody spoke Yiddish. Towns like this were a lot of them. And everybody spoke Yiddish. So...
How many synagogues were in Jetel?
Oh, there are three synagogues and a Talmud Torah. Synagogues, the three, we had the middle, the main synagogue, the middle synagogue, and another synagogue. I forget what's the name of it. And I think we were going to the main synagogue. They were all Orthodox. There was nothing else.
When did you go to the synagogue?
I think on the Shabbat.
Were you able to follow the prayers?
I don't think so, no. No, I didn't. I wasn't because I didn't have any training for prayer, for the Judaism. So I didn't know how to speak or read Hebrew. I knew the letters, but that's about it. I couldn't follow the prayers. Well, everything about Judaism, what I learned here, is a lot more than I learned as a child.
What are your earliest memories of your mother?
She was a very warm person, very loving. The children had a priority where there was nothing could interrupt her involvement with the child. When the child was sick, she dropped everything and went to the child. I don't know how old I was then, but I have very good feelings about my mother. She's a very dedicated person. She loved my father and she took care of him very well because he was a little bit sick. He had chronic bronchitis and she kept him in good condition. And then later she took very good care of me when I needed help during the war. But she was a very warm person. But I don't know how old I was when I can remember my mother. I remember my mother very well. But I don't know since when I remember my mother.
What was your father like?
My father was a little, he was very smart, very intelligent. He didn't have a formal education, but he was very, very studious. I mean, he but he was very very intelligent, very smart. He organized, he transformed himself into a bookkeeper without any training. He organized a system. This is later on when the store was taken away during the Russian occupation. He organized a system how to accounting for the what was he doing? Where was the bookkeeper in bakery? The bakery. He had good training in religious aspect of Judaism, but then something happened and he got disappointed or what, and he totally switched from orthodoxy to totally non-believer. I don't know if non-believer could be then, but he was totally outside the like, for instance, we used to go to synagogue on Shabbat, but we kept kosher at home, but we were not very orthodox.
What were the rest of the Jews in Jethel like in that regard? Were most of them observant, or were some?
Yeah, most of them were. The kids that went to the Yiddish Volksschule were not as observant.
What kind of school was that?
There was a. That's where I went. It was everything was taught in Yiddish. And you get elementary school education. You go at 7 grades. And I never finished my 7th grade. The war interrupted my education when I was with the finishing of the 6th grade. And then when the Russians came, they sent us back 2 years. So again, I went up to my 7th, but I never finished my 7th grade. I have very good feelings about the school. I had a lot of friends over there, and and we used to play a lot and study a lot. I remember taking the countries we had in geography. We had to color the different countries and spend hours on that and doing it. But I love to go to school there.
Do you remember any of your teachers?
I remember my Polish teacher, Hornstein. And we had Polish. Polish was like a foreign language to us. We had Polish 1 hour a day. And it was, and even during the hour, we still spoke everything in Yiddish. Occasionally, we throw in a Polish word. So Polish is not my language, which I could converse in. There was no need for me to know Polish because I didn't have any Polish friends. I didn't have anybody to speak Polish with.
Who were your friends?
So Jewish kids. But my age, I remember I used to play chess and play that some one game was called Poland, and it's not Poland, it's Poland, and it's almost like baseball here. You hit the ball and you try to run around the bases, same thing. It's a small town, and you know everybody. Everybody knows you. So you never felt alone. You always said people are. Because it's a small, everybody knew everybody else. Everybody knew everybody's business. That was a joke.
Were there town festivities?
I remember we had in school, the festivities were, in school, we used to have once a year some plays, performances. There was a money-making venture for the school, because those were private schools and they were not supported by the government, at least not to my knowledge. So we used to have it end of the year. Plays. I participated in those.
Do you remember some of the plays that you participated in?
It didn't make such a very strong impression on me, impact on me. I don't. But I remember some melodies. But you don't want me to do that.
Oh, yeah. What if you would like to?
Well, we had a choir, and the teacher was organizing something like a life through songs. Each song represents a different part of your life, like when you go to Cheder, if in Pripetschik brennt a fire, und ich tue bis heis, und der Rebbe lernt kleine Kinder lach, um it's all a base. I'm sure you know that.
What is the meaning of the words?
It shows how the house is old. Pripetschik, what is Pripetschik? Just where they had this fire going, like a stove. And the Shtubis Heis means the house is hot. And the rabbi learns little children the Hebrew alphabet from its other base. And this goes on, later on it goes in when they get a little older, the two boys are sitting under a tree and dreaming about. The girls came into the picture, and then the next song is you fell in love with a girl and then you supposedly get married and then comes the poverty. Was very, very, very economically very deprived. And it shows like Zuntig Burbe, Montig Burbe, Dinsik Mitwa Burbe, Donashing Friday Burbe, Shabbos Nanona Burbe, Kugala Zuntig Maita Burbe. It means every day you eat potatoes. Every day. And then it tells you that a mother is trying to, there is Magazine soll beachten und betten noch zwei. Wenn es kommt in der Nacht, wir schlafen dann sie. Drei mit den Taten und drei mit der Mami. Händler und Fiesler geflochten zusammen. It means that the mother is making a family of eight people, only two beds. So when the night comes, how do they sleep? Three sleep with the daddy and three children sleep with the mother. And the hands like a fistler, the hands and the legs are geflochten, like braided together. And then it says, when it comes from the Nacht, when the night comes and you have to make the beds, then he from the mommy them to eat up the bed, and then starts the mother to ask about her death. Says, like I wonder. It, and there is no wonder why she does it, because no matter how crowded you are in a grave, you sleep by yourself. You sleep separately. Then, but we had the poverty was very, very. I don't remember being hungry, but there must have been some very hungry people in my hometown. Not as, there were some help organizations which will help you. Everything is done by the members of my town. If you had a good very good craftsman, you made pretty good money. My uncle was a very good tailor, and they made pretty good money. He made pretty good money.
Who were some of the other craftsmen?
Oh, there were shoemakers, tailors, carpenters. And there were some traders. Every Tuesday we had a big market. All the farmers from around the town came to the town and sold their goods there, and bought things what they needed. That was a big day for the store, because that's when you did most of the business.
What did you do in the store and on market day?
What did I do in the store on market day? I didn't do any selling, though, because I was only about 10 years old. But I remember every day when I came home from school, I go to the store to my parents. After I had something to eat from my grandmother. I didn't do any selling or anything like that. I actually was just an observer in the store. If my father had something for me to do, like some buttons sorted out, I'll do it. I don't remember if he paid me for that or not.
We're going to change tapes. This is cassette 2 with Morris Rosnow. You were saying about the buttons you sorted in your father's store.
Yeah, well, when they had something for me to do, I was doing it, but I was not very often. But I like the market days, because everybody was busier, the store was busier, and everybody was involved in it, you know. See a lot of people there, but mainly, and even you bought your chicken for the Shabbat, and you bought all the things which you need for the winter. We used to buy wood for the winter, and you go and you want to make sure that your wood is total there, and you buy a chicken for the Shabbat, and maybe some fish. Anyway, it was a very exciting day. That was an exciting day of the week. as far as the relation between the Jewish population and the farmers was very wasn't much. I mean, we were not on a business level only. It wasn't. You didn't go to each other's houses. First of all, it was far. You lived in a very concentrated area. And they used to come from the surrounding areas. But there was no socializing, not to my knowledge. Maybe my sister had a girlfriend that was a Polish girlfriend. But there was no socializing. I didn't have any Polish friends at all.
Of the non-Jews in the town of Zhetel, how many of them were Polish, and were there other ethnicities there as well?
Maybe there were some gypsies, but they were either Polish or Belarusians. And the Polish part of the population were involved in the managing the city. They were the civic workers. But the police, the mayor was, I think it had a mayor. But I was so much removed from the politics of the town.
Tell me a little more about your sisters, and what did they do, and what was your relationship with them like?
Well, I have two sisters. One is about a year and a half older than me. The other one is 5 years older than me. Well, we went through the similar system. Both of them went through the same elementary school where I was. When you graduated, you really didn't have, I think this was the end of your education, or at least 90% of the population, there was the end, the seventh grades. But during the seventh grades, I think you were better educated than the seventh grader here. And then some people went to go to the gymnasium, which is high school, was very difficult, was very expensive, and you had to get out of town, be away from town, and that was very prohibitive. So most of the people didn't go. One of my sisters went to Vilno, and she went to the Real Gymnasium. It's the only Jewish speaking high school in Poland, maybe, I don't know. And that was very expensive. The reason we could make it is because I had an uncle that lived in Vilno, and my sister could stay with them.
Which sister was it?
Mira, my older sister. She could stay with them. So she went to Vilno and stayed with them and went to the Real Gymnasium. It was called Real Gymnasium. Even my older sister was about, she 16, 17, or maybe. So she didn't work. I mean, it's not that she had a job. There were no jobs available. You got to learn a trade. If you want a job, you got to learn a trade. So, anyway, anything else you would like to know?
Did you have a particular trade that you were going to learn?
I don't know what I would have done. I had no idea. No idea. Normally, you went to your father's trade. Maybe I would have and taken over the store. I don't know. But I didn't have any specific plan or anything like that. Maybe I would have sold insurance like my father did. But it was not... You were very dependent on your family. I couldn't see myself being on my own completely. It was very limited as far as movement.
Did you have any favorite subjects that you particularly like to study in the Yiddish Volksschule?
I don't remember. No, I don't think I had any favorite subjects. I enjoyed all of them in a way. I liked recess quite a bit. We used to play, go out in the yard and play. But I don't remember any favorite subjects. But I want to sing a song for you.
Okay.
A song about the hymn of the Yiddish Volksschule. And it goes like that. Wir haben geblanchet die Stäubige Wagen gelitten verfinstert. A lange Zeit bis wann in die Yiddische Schule ist gekommen. Sie hat unser Leben bei Freit und bei Neid. Wir haben genug in der Finster getappt, genug in die Tieren, die Fremde geklappt. So lassen wir sie singen, begeisterungsvoll. So leben die jüdische Schule. It's finished.
What does it mean?
Now, what does it mean? It means we were wandering in the world, in the shuttle of world, in Stoibike wagon with dusty roads and all that, and gelitten and verfinstert lange Zeit, and it means that we were searching for our shul, which was not there, and until the shul the Yiddish Volksschule came, our life got rejuvenated, right? So let us sing with enthusiasm. Long live the Yiddish Shul. So that's but. Oh, I remember other songs also. But I don't know if. I don't remember what I was. We had a choir in our shul, and that's why. And we also had an orchestra. I was playing the mandolin, and even today I still play. I don't know the notes, but I play it out of my ear. The mandolin. Well, what else do you want me to tell you?
On the eve of World War II, what was life like in Jethel between the outside world and the Jewish world in which you lived?
Well, there was a lot of tension because Nazism was coming in Germany, and Germany is right next to Poland. I remember my father was always talking politics with some people, and radio was not readily available. So maybe there were about two or three radios in the whole town, and so the people already knew to come to listen to the BBC. That was the main news source. And so they already had the door open, and people come in and listen to the news. And then comes the discussion. What does it mean? What does it mean, and what is going to happen? My father was very active in that, and his opinion counted very heavily. His opinion counted. Mm-hmm. People respected his opinion. He was also on the board of the school, the Yiddish Volksschule. But there was a lot of tension.
Do you remember some of the discussions, some of the things that were said?
Oh, what is it? Well, basically because the Jewish people were very much afraid, the Germans, because we already knew their anti-Semitic dogma. And Soviet, that was very, oh, so what do you think is going to do that, remember England and France were the major powers then, from the First World War. And nobody could imagine that they're going to be defeated or anything like that. So you just rationalize. But the tension was there, and as a child I could feel it very much.
How did that affect you?
Well, I was afraid. It didn't affect my life because we continued going to school, and was very much basically, I was just afraid.
Were there any newspapers in Jeto?
Yeah. We subscribed to a Polish newspaper. I don't know if it came from Jeto. No, it wasn't. I don't think it was print. It came from Vilno or something like that, a bigger town. It was called Robotnik because my father was a socialist. Robotnik means worker. So that's, I remember you subscribed to that paper. But otherwise there were no local papers.
Do you remember hearing about the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact?
Oh yeah.
What kind of reaction did people have to that?
In my hometown, it was beautiful. We had a very positive reaction because the Russian army occupied our area, and that was great. My father was in seventh heaven. Communism came to Jeto.
When did the Russian army come to Jeto?
It was right. Let's see, the war broke out on September 1, 1939. Maybe within a couple of days, 2-3 days, 4 days, by the end of the week.
How did they come into the town?
Tanks. And I remember my uncle came from Vilno because he thought they were going to bomb Vilno. So he came to Jeto and stayed with us. To be safer. We had tanks, they had artillery. It was an army, I've never seen anything like it. But my uncle was very smart.
Which uncle?
My uncle from Vilno, very smart. He noticed right away that, you know, the streets in Jeto were not built for tanks. So there were cobble streets, and so the tanks made a little imprint, and then another tank made a little more of an imprint, the third one, and then continued going, and nobody fixed it. Nobody fixed it. It just made the hole a little bit deeper. But they didn't fix it. And he said, how can an army that doesn't do it, how can a system like this be efficient or anything like that? He knew right away. A lot of tanks came in, I thought this invincible. And I remember the Russian soldiers they were very friendly. And the little symbols they wear on their heads, it was such a nice thing to have, because it made you feel important. And you climb up on the soldiers and you tell them. You motion to him that that's what you want. He'll take it off and give it to you. And they had lots of money. And they used to come in the store. Business was so good. They didn't buy an item. They bought a whole box, a whole shelf.
What did they like to buy?
Anything and everything. A whole shelf. Because they're so hungry for material goods. So business was good, but the problem was you couldn't replace it. You sell the shelf of whatever you have on the shelf, but then you can't replace it. So that was the end of your prosperity, in a way. I remember one guy, he had a little watch, hand watch, and he paid about 10 zlotys, and he thought a ruble is a zloty, the same. The Russian community offered him 50 rubles. He thought, geez, I can buy 5 like this. So he sold it, but he couldn't buy another one. So that was...
How did you communicate with them?
The Russians? Well, we knew Russian. Because Belarus is very similar to Russian. If you know one, you can make yourself understood in the second one. And the general population over there, my mother knew Russian very well. And because that was, and also Poland was under the Russian occupation till the end of the First World War. It's part of Russia. So we communicated, okay.
What sorts of social and political changes occurred when the Soviet Army came in?
Well, I remember the store was gone. The store which we had was gone. My father didn't sell any fire insurance. In my family, he changed to a bookkeeper.
When did he lose the store?
As soon as he came in, he erased all the stores. He made a park out of the area. Maybe within a couple of weeks, the merchandise we had, we traded with the farmers to get some food. But as far as the business, it was gone. So we had to completely change our income, my father had to completely change his lifestyle, his life. But he was very happy to do it because he was so enthusiastic about socialism.
What was your mother's reaction?
My mother was. She didn't have to run anymore to borrow money. run to one, borrow money and 20 zlotys or so and pay somebody else, then borrow next thing, borrow from somebody else to pay that. That was very painful. So we did pretty good. The Russians, there was no persecution against the Jews at all. And as a child, I remember having very, very good memories.
Was there a change in the religious life of Zhetel?
Yeah.
What were the changes?
The change was that the synagogues were closed. No synagogue.
How did that affect the people who went there to pray?
I guess people who went there to pray every day, it affected them. Or maybe they prayed someplace else. But it didn't affect me. Because we were already removed from the super ultra Orthodox. And actually, it was for me the life under the Russians was actually good. I was not involved in politics or anything like that. But as a child, they keep you very busy. You have meetings, you have this and that and this and that.
What sort of meetings?
Oh, you know, the different organizations, they take a baby when it's born from the cradle to the grave. You are involved in communism. The first ones are the octavers. Those are the little ones. And then come the pioneer. And then come the komsomolets. And then comes then you are a communist. Then there is a party. So you can go through the system from the very beginning.
You mentioned earlier that they had put you back two grades.
Yeah.
Did your education take place in Russian, in the Russian language, or did you?
No, still the same Yiddish. Yiddish was the dominant language.
Did the subject matter change?
No, maybe there was. I'm sure there was a lot of built-in brainwashing or whatever you can call it. About communism and all that, but it was. But geography was geography. We went to school the same time. But they felt that their educational level was more advanced, which was. And so that's why it set us back 2 years.
Did you become part of one of the groups?
Yeah, I belonged to the pioneers. After they accepted, they thought I'm not a threat to the government. Because at the beginning, because my father had a little store, so he wasn't qualified. I wasn't, and I felt bad about it because all my friends joined, and I couldn't. So they rejected me. But then they accepted me.
How long?
A couple months, maybe.
What were the activities in the pioneers?
Oh yeah, you talk about the activities. You study about Stalin, how wonderful he is, and how great he is, and how everything what we have here because he gave it to us is we should always all our life we should thank him for that. And we had history of communism, of Russian communism. Everything was done perfectly. But basically, otherwise, there are some other families they were considered a threat to the system, and they were arrested and deported deep into Russia.
Did you hear about that then?
Yeah. It was in my hometown. They did it. Several families. One girl, the daughter of one that married one of the... No, she married somebody else anyway. But she's now in Israel. and they were deported. But how little we knew that those were the fortunate ones, because they didn't have to go through the Holocaust. And they were all. And also during the 2 year occupation, we had during the occupation we had. I've lost my train of thought for a second. Oh yeah, well, we had some refugees that came from the western part of Poland under the German occupation, and tell us about all the abuses and all the atrocities committed against the Jewish people. But we didn't believe them. My mother didn't believe them. My father didn't believe them. How could it be? After all, these are the same Germans that went through my hometown during the First World War. And they were fraternizing with the Jewish population. And how could they turn into such murderers all of a sudden? But we found out that it was true, but we didn't believe them.
What did they tell you?
Oh, how they persecuted the Jews, killing and all that. We thought maybe you have to work or you have to, but outright killing, that was never entered anybody's mind.
We're going to change tapes.
Okay.
I need to. This is cassette 3 with Morris Rosnow. The refugees who came to Jetel, where did most of them come from?
From the western part of Poland, which was under the German occupation. They just went, you know, smuggle yourself through.
Did you actually hear them talking with your parents?
Yeah. There was one lived across the street from us. And he was coming to play chess with my father. And he was talking about that. The beating the Jews, hitting them. Atrocities which we never could visualize. And that was another reason why you just wouldn't believe that something horrible like this could happen. And this was the Germans, you know, they had. It's not a forsaken country. It was an industrialized, cultural people. How could they do things like that? But they did it. So you don't believe it. And what could you do even if you knew and you wanted to get out of the situation? You didn't have a place to go. There was no place to go. The money was not there to travel. And there was no place you could go. The whole world shut the doors, closed their ears, shut the ears, the eyes, didn't see, didn't hear, and there was nothing you could do.
Did your family consider leaving?
No, I don't remember that. Maybe my mother talked to my father, or my father to my mother, but it didn't involve the kids.
Did any families leave for Palestine, for instance?
No. The only family that left was the one which were deported by the Russians.
Were you still able to listen to the radio during the Soviet occupation?
Well, I don't know if you could listen to a BBC. The tension was there. I mean, there was... The Russians didn't want you to listen to BBC or any foreign news, because they had their own interpretation of the news. I remember somebody was talking to us when the war between the Germany, between Germany and England or France, and one shot down three airplanes and another one shot down two airplanes or something. He says, for us, it's a gain of five airplanes. Because they were both enemies of the Soviet Union. And they changed. They took somebody, there was another thing which made an impression that they took the workers who were supposed to be liberated from the yoke of the exploiters and all that, and they were supposed to be on top of the world. So there was elections, and the elections were, I don't know, I'd never been to elections before in my life. Poland didn't have any elections. And they took some a worker, maybe a mill, a shoemaker, good shoemaker, and he was rewarded for being such a dedicated worker, so they made him a representative to the government. So what did they accomplish? They took a good shoemaker and made him representative. They took another shoemaker and made him head of the factory or something. So they lost the good shoemaker and didn't gain anything. Administrator. And that was the system.
Did your father continue to be supportive of the communist ideology?
Yeah. I remember him telling me, even he says, well, the future is not in America, the future is in Russia. But you guys are too young and you don't understand it. He totally misjudged the whole thing. I remember when I came to the West, Stalin was always glamorized in a giant. And I saw in the newspaper, I saw how small he was. I couldn't believe it. You know, you get indoctrinated by such a important, everything. If you get a book in mathematics, if it wasn't for Stalin, you couldn't even have mathematics. Everything was glorified Stalin, and the Communist Party and this and this and this. It was totally part of your. You have to thank Stalin for everything that's good that's happening to you.
Were there any songs that you learned about Stalin?
About Stalin? You want me to sing a little more, right? Well, I know the Russian anthem. Союз нерушимых республик свободных, Светила навеки великая Русь, Да здравствует созданный волей народов Единый могучий Советский Союз. Славься, Отечество наше свободное, Дружба народов, на-на-на-на-на, is not Russian. Знамя советское, знамя свободное, пусть от победы к победе выжжет. Anyway, but this was not in effect, this anthem was not in effect when they came to us. the international was the end to Russia. This happened during the war, when Stalin realized that somehow the people don't want to fight for him. So he had to inject a little bit of patriotism. But you understood what I said, right?
I understood, but maybe you can translate it for people
okay,
who don't know.
Well, this was the союзные большими республик свободы. The union of the republics, which are the strong republics, freedom, Switzerland of Yekiv Yedikai Rus, that organized forever the great Russia. The philosophy is certainly one of the, I'm saying it because I can't, long live, created by the will of the people. The only strong of Sovietsky Soyuz, Soviet Union. Okay, let's see. But every Russian song was full of propaganda.
Did you receive news about the movement of the German front towards Shetel?
You mean after the war started?
Mm-hmm. After the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact was...
Well, the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact was just for the partition of Poland.
When Hitler invaded Russia, what... Do you remember hearing news about that, right?
Oh yeah, but that's what that. Well, the war didn't come to us until 1941, June 22nd, 1941. This is when the war started in Russia and Germany.
Was it a surprise to the?
Yeah, very much a surprise. Very much a surprise. And the biggest surprise that the Russians couldn't they were retreating right from the first minute. They couldn't hold the front. They couldn't fight the Germans then. I mean the big Russian army that we saw coming in through going through Shetel was like paper.
What did you see on June 22nd, 1941?
Airplanes. Airplanes were flying overhead in the direction of Russia. It was total collapse right from the start. They couldn't hold the front at all. And then within 1 week, the Germans were in our town. 1 week. It was very sad. We felt, especially the Jewish population, felt very, very sad about it. Because we wanted the Russians to be there. And they couldn't handle it. There were a lot of Jewish, like my cousin, he ran away with the Russian army when they retreated. Quite a few kids. Well, they were not kids then, but now they look to me like kids. Ran away with the Russian army because it was they knew about the Germans. And there was no place to go. The only place for us to go was Russia.
Who were the first Germans to come into Shetel?
Parachutists, parachute jumpers. and they came as for food. We gave them food, and we thought, well, they're not so bad. They're very polite. They asked for food. But those were the soldiers on the front, not the SS or anything like that.
When did the SS arrive?
A little bit later, after a couple of weeks, right behind the German army. And we were, the commandant two, the German commandant two came. The military government established themselves in Zettel for the whole area. And that's when the whole problem, that's when the whole thing started.
What was the first thing that the SS proceeded to do?
The first thing what they did is they got about 6 or 7 names of Jewish people that were cooperating with the Russians. They came to their house. They came to the house because he knew where everybody lives. And they took him out and killed him right then, arrested them. That was the first victims.
Was that done publicly, or did they take them out?
They arrested them, but they didn't kill him on the spot. They took him to prison and killed him there. By the first mom, on a mass scale, the order came out for all the Jewish people to wear yellow patches on the back and the front of your jacket. And it didn't make any difference how old you were. You always had to wear it. It was a round yellow patch. It wasn't the Mogen David. A round yellow patch.
What was your family's reaction to that ordinance?
Well, you did it. You were ordered to do it, so you do it. Because if you don't do it, you get killed. There was no trial. The civil rights were gone. There were no trials or anything like that. It was, so you did that. And then you had to, myself, I couldn't go to school anymore. Jewish kids couldn't go to school. The Jews, we couldn't walk on the sidewalks. We had to walk in the gutters. You never knew when you went outside if you'll come back, because they round you up and take you to work someplace. It was not a question of paying for your work. It was slave labor all from the very, very beginning.
Did you see roundups occurring?
Yeah, they took. I was too young for that, but they took him and take. Somehow they came back. And they took him to work someplace. My father was working in a mill, in a lumber mill. And my sisters were going to school. I was going to school. No, really, no. No, I'm talking about a long time. No. No, no school. They rounded you up and they take you to work.
When was your father working in the lumber mill?
When the Germans came in. After a month or so. And he had a certificate that he was working in the lumber mill.
When they issued the yellow patches, how did you receive them?
Well, they didn't issue it. They told you to wear it. They told you to wear it. You had to get it yourself. You have to get it yourself. We didn't have a lot of clothes, so we didn't need too many patches. But I don't know how we got them, actually, because yellow was not a very popular color. But I guess you could get it.
Did the Jews have to register?
No, I don't remember them. I don't remember that standing in line to register, no. But it was so obvious, you know, it's not, they are so segregated, so separate already, the Jewish people. That it was not difficult to find out who's Jewish, who's not Jewish, and all that.
Did you understand any of the German that they spoke?
No, I didn't. But some people did. And but German to me was like Yiddish. It's similar names. So maybe a word here or there I could understand, but that's about it.
Were you ever stopped on the street for any reason?
Not me.
Was anybody that you know stopped on the street at the beginning of the occupation?
Not to my knowledge. Then started the persecution started. That you had to surrender all your gold, surrender all your valuables, and also when they realized that the war was going to go into the winter, I think they thought they'll defeat Russia before even the winter was coming. So they collected all the warm clothes. And you had to surrender all your sweaters, all your fur, all this. And you do it. Because there was no alternative, otherwise they kill you. And people were standing in line to surrender this, and they took out, that I saw myself also, they took out a couple people, just to show an example, and accused them of trying to hide the gold pieces, and kill them right there. That was done in front of everybody.
Who did they kill?
They killed two or three people, Jewish people.
Did you know them?
Yeah.
Do you remember their names? Did your family have any gold or silver?
We had a few pieces of gold, but we didn't. We didn't surrender it. We hid it in the wall.
How did you hide it in the wall?
In the wall, behind. You know the wall. It had some tile, so we dug out the tile. And he did that. And I don't know what happened to it. It vanished from the house, I guess. Somebody found it. I didn't. I wasn't even looking for it. It was a couple pieces, which was not that big a value, but it was.
What happened after they confiscated the silver and gold from the townsfolks?
Well, then the ghetto came into organizing.
When did that?
Oh no! I forgot a very important thing happened. They had they told all the Jewish people. The men, Jewish men between the ages of 18 and 45 or something like that, together at the marketplace. And when you came there, when we came there, they had a list of about 120 Jewish intellectuals, people the Germans thought could organize a society, a community, resistance within a community. And they told them they're going to take him to work, to work in a camp. But they actually took him out, they loaded him up in automobiles, and they took him out outside town and killed him.
Did you see them gathered in the town square?
Yeah.
Why were you there?
I was not there as a participant, but I was there because there was I don't remember why I was there, but I happened to be in that area, and I didn't see it very closely, but from a distance, I saw what's happening.
Did you find out that they had been shot?
We found out very soon afterwards. And my father was on the list also, my father. But since he had Königberg, he was sick. And I remember that we ran to the German army, right behind our house, because there was a Hebrew elementary school and they had some space. So they were camping over there. And I said, what do we do? What do we do? My father is sick. Well, if he's sick, he should stay home, one German. And I'm not involved in that. I don't know. And he was... my father stayed home. That's how I got saved. And this affected the survival of my family, as you'll see later on.
How did you find out that the 120 intellectuals had been shot? Who told you?
Well, the farmers, and they never came back. The best indication is that they never came back. There was never any contact with them.
What was the reaction among the people you knew?
It was terrible, because there were a lot of people you know. My friend's father got killed, mainly father, because we were too young to be the brother, and so it was very, very, very tragic. But then came the ghetto into existence. They cordoned off a few streets and ordered all the Jewish people to move into that area.
When did that occur?
This happened in, you want the date?
The year?
The year 1942. 42 was about April.
What area did they cordon off?
A few streets, which was our house. We didn't have our own home. We rented it, an apartment, two-bedroom apartment, and happened to be within the ghetto limits, so we didn't have to move. But my uncle, my aunt, and the two children, that he's a tailor, they moved in with us.
So what was his name?
Yershul Benjaminovich, and a Hamke. And two children. The reason I'm saying two children, they had three children. The third, the middle one, the middle son, ran away with the Russian army. And he got killed over there. He died from dysentery. And they moved in with us, which was a very... To me, that was not a big tragedy, because I felt very strange about the ghetto of you, because you're surrounded by wires. You can't go in, you can't go out. you need a special permit to leave the area. And they separated the Jewish people from the rest of the population.
How long did it take them to construct the ghetto?
I don't know how long. Well, they didn't have to
wire that you mentioned.
I don't know how long it took him.
What was the wire?
Probably it was barbed wire and a gate. And a gate. There were two gates into the ghetto. From different parts of the ghetto.
I'm going to change tapes.
Okay.
This is cassette 4 with Morris Rosnow. You were describing the ghetto in Jetel.
Yeah. The head of the ghetto was a citizen of Jetel. Was Alta Dvoretsky. He was a lawyer by profession. Very handsome man, knew German very well. And I remember that the Germans were totally, couldn't understand how he could be Jewish even. Because he didn't look like Jew, according to their terminology of Jewish. Didn't even look like Jewish. And he was very intelligent. He most likely is a German someplace. Anyway. And he was also starting to organize the resistance. And I think that maybe this only instance where the head of the ghetto was also the head of the resistance. I was not involved in that myself, but that's a fact. All of a sudden, one morning, June 1942, the ghetto was surrounded by police and Germans, and the order was for all the Jewish people to come to the old cemetery, and the families stay together. So the apprehension was extreme. You didn't know what to expect. When we came to there was total. It was terrible. There were the Germans, the Jewish people, police running around, and ordering everybody, yelling. Raus, schnell. And a German officer was standing with a spick-and-span polished boots, and they were trying to separate the old people, the children, people that didn't have anybody working in their family, and sick people. They separated about 1,000 people from Shettle. And they took him out, and it was already pre-dark graves, and just killed him. That was a terrible trauma. A lot of families that got left without their, when they took the 120 out, they took the head of the family out, so they didn't have anybody working. So they were no good. So that's why I'm saying that if my father would have gone and taken away, maybe our family couldn't survive the first onslaught.
Where were you in June of 42 when the people were killed?
Well, what the rest of the people went back into the ghetto. And the people they selected, about 1,000 people, they took them, they had to walk right through the city, through the town, to the other side, where the graves were. I went back. We stayed as a family, and we went back to the ghetto. And they took him out in groups of 10 or 12. Took him out, and they had to get undressed, and they just killed him. It was awful.
Were you able to hear anything?
Yeah, we could hear the shooting, but we couldn't. The shooting we could hear. And a lot of my friends got killed. The families got killed. And that was really terrible. My grandmother got very confused, and she got separated from us. And she says, "I'm only a grandmother," in Yiddish she was talking. And they killed them. The policeman killed her right on the cemetery.
Did you see that?
Yeah. That was terrible. I never seen a dead person before, and here's my grandmother just like that, killed. It was awful. She was such a pious woman. All the time she spent is to help other families that were in need, and she didn't have a mean bone in her body. And why kill her? Well, that's what happened. The rest of the people went back to the ghetto. And life continued, but the thing that happened then is that the people already knew. I mean, because that the Germans are out to kill every Jew under their control. And it didn't make any difference how rich you are, how valuable you are. If you are Jewish, your destiny was sealed. You had to die. And people started to build hiding places where to hide. There was no long-term planning to find out where do I hide, and why? What am I going to do if I survive? Where am I going to go? There was no place to go. But you know, that's a normal human reaction. If somebody wants to kill you, you hide. We built in our house where we lived, we built 3 hiding places. One was because it was a duplex. Half of it belonged to the father and to the parents, and half of it belongs to the son. We lived in the side that belonged to the parents. We rented an apartment. So there was the hiding places, there were three hiding places. One was like in our house, we had a cellar. There was a cellar which was also used as a refrigerator in the summer. So we built an extra room, and it was camouflaged, was hidden. And then, and the other place was, because it was a duplex, and it was, they had a, there was a partition in the attic. So we built an extra wall, and in between the two walls. And the third place was a storage area outside. We also built a, an extra wall. So we had three hiding places. And then we waited. People were still going to work. My father still went to work.
Where was he working?
At a mill, lumber mill. I don't know if, I don't think he got paid for it.
Was your mother working?
No. Mother was at home.
How did you obtain food?
I'm trying to remember. It was all, there was some wood, food given to through the usual administrative procedures. Some food was given to the handed out. And then they didn't care. You had to provide your own food.
How often did they hand out food?
I don't know. I think maybe once a day, if I remember correctly. But I know one thing, that we were always hungry. I was always hungry. I was always hungry and I was always afraid, totally afraid and hungry. There was, I remember one guy was living close by to us, and we had a well, water well. So the water well supplied water for the area. And he was afraid to go on the street to the water well in case the Germans come in and start and kidnap the Jews. So he used to go around, go to our back of us, which was a lot longer for him to do, but that's how he went to the water well, so he's not exposed in the street. There was the general attitude, the fear on the people. And this was going on for a couple of months, 2-3 months. Oh, in the meantime, the head of the Judenrat, this was the time when the partisans started to organize resistance. He wanted to liberate the ghetto. But the Russian partisans were not happy about that. For two reasons. They didn't want to suffer, they didn't want to fight for the Jews either. And they didn't want to, and they didn't want to lose, to people get killed, partisans get killed to liberate the Jews. So they saw a threat in the Alta Dvoretsky. They saw a threat in him. He was intelligent, too intelligent. They couldn't relate to him. So they killed him. The Russian partisans killed him. And then in August. In August,
Of what year?
1942. It was still 1942. They surrounded together again. I happened to be sick that morning. I had a boil in my, from all places, in my throat. But it's unbelievable when I think about that. It's unbelievable that, you know, when the boil busted that morning, when the ghetto was surrounded. And somehow I felt okay, you know, when the boil busted. It broke. And they ordered the Jews again to gather at the cemetery. Families stayed together. We decided as a family not to go. We went down in the hiding place. And we went down in the hiding place in through by the cellar. In that, when we went down, my sisters didn't want to go down there. They went to a different place. They went to the place where they had a storage and the double wall. But I went down with my parents. And we found a baby in our group. And the baby was crying. And it's unbelievable. And I'm looking at my grandchildren today. And the baby was less than a year old. And all of a sudden, the baby was crying. All of a sudden, the baby was not crying anymore. What happened is the mother choked the baby to death. That was unreal. But what can you do, you know? If in order for the survival of the group, they couldn't survive with the baby crying. There was a lot of shooting going on. A lot of shooting. They found the hiding place for the other group. The Germans, the police found it.
Which other group?
Well, the hiding places were built in different areas. I mean, people organized themselves, and they built a hiding place. One, not all the same, but. This was just for our, we built for us. And so they were shooting all day long, shooting. They found the people and they killed them right there. And we stayed there during the day, and they didn't find our hiding place.
Who was hiding with you?
We had about 10, 12 people. There were people that lived in the same duplex, or maybe they came from outside. And we were hiding together. That was when my father was suffering very much. He couldn't. There was not enough air, and with him having chronic bronchitis, it was made it even harder. So we decided we'll go down. We'll go up to the attic. At least you have air. But before we went up, my father went to take a look what happened to the hiding place where my sisters were. He was locked. He knocked on the door, but nobody answered. They were so terrified. They wouldn't even answer. And they knew it, but they were so terrified they couldn't even answer. And so we didn't know what happened to them. The next day we stayed over there, and there was a shooting, and all of a sudden I hear, because it was thin, the walls were thin, and you could hear what's happening outside. They opened up the ghetto for looting. And the farmers from the area came and were running around and looting. There was not much to loot, but still something for nothing or something like that. So all of a sudden, I hear, Raus, the time came to stop looting. So you stop looting, the German efficiency is plugs in, and yelling, get out. And so we thought, maybe this will be, that's the end of it. I didn't know what happened to the rest of the Jews. But what happened, they selected out about 200 or 300 craftsmen. And they sent them to, the rest of them were killed. The rest of the Jews were killed.
How many were killed?
Well, the total population was about 3,500 Jewish people, and 1,000, 2,500, maybe about 2,000, a little more than 2,000.
What did they do with the craftsmen?
They organized a house in Novogurek, and they were working there.
I'm going to change tapes. This is cassette 5 with Morris Rosnow. You were discussing the craftsmen who were selected from the roundup and their fate.
Well, they were taken to Novogurek, which was a town about 50 miles from Zhytel. And and that's where they were working. And they lived over there. I mean, they lived in a house. One house, that's all it was. At the end, they built a tunnel. They built a tunnel underneath the house all the way to the other side. this other side of the street, and one morning they all ran away. The whole group of people. It was unbelievable to build a tunnel under these kind of conditions, because they had to hide every speck of dirt. Because the house was inspected every day in the morning. And they had to hide each one of them. And they built a tunnel, and the tragedy of this is, it was raining that night, very much. And a lot of people went out and didn't know where to go, didn't know what to do. So they ended up in the same place after wandering all night. But some survived. And, one of the survivors was Yitzhak Benjaminovich, a brother of my uncle, who came several nights before, and took his family out from the hiding place. And took him to their place where they were working. And being promised by the Germans that bring your families and you'll be all safe. And he came to the hiding place and took out his wife and his two children, and the middle child ran away with the Russian army. She survived. She survived, and she's the only one that survived out of the family. He took him out and took him to the, and the Germans, well, they were quite, what they say and do is two different things. And they got killed. My uncle, who lived with us, was also. He was offered to stay alive with his oldest son. Because the younger son and the wife, they wouldn't let him stay alive. So they decided to go to their death together as a family. And that he did want to survive without his wife and the child. So they got all killed. And what happened? There are different things, different from different people that survived there. That were there, and they. They kept them. They rounded them up and kept them in a play in the keynote in the theater building in Shetland for several days without food or water or anything. And then they took him to Novogorod. That was the end of the ghetto.
Well, where were you during this time? Were you still hiding in the?
Anyway, we came out again that night, and my father went again to see what happened to my sisters. The door was open, and there was nobody there in the hiding place. So he was sure that they discovered them, and they killed my sisters are dead. I remember we had to get out of this. We couldn't stay there forever, down in the hiding place. So we went out and we went to Dvorets.
Where was Dvorets?
Dvorets is it's about a town about 10 miles from Shetland. And they had over there, they had an airport. This is the place where they took the 400, well, anyway. They had an airport, and it was a safer ghetto. They thought it was a safer ghetto.
Why did you think that?
Because the people worked at the airport, and it was considered a concentration camp. They didn't have any ovens, but it was a considered a concentration camp.
Did you know about the ovens at that time?
No. We didn't know anything about it. And they... stayed over there anyway.
Why did your family decide to go to Dvorets?
You got to go someplace. There was no other choice. I didn't know. We thought maybe if the ghetto is still functioning, we'll go into the ghetto. Because there was no place to go. You got to go someplace. And you can't go, you got to go in a place which is relatively close by, so you can make it in one night. So Dvorets seems like it was the right choice. And it was the right choice for us. Because when we came to Dvorets, we sent in a couple scouts from our group to see if the ghetto is still in existence. And when they came back, casually, my father asked him, did you see Sora and did you see my two sisters? Oh yeah, he saw them. They are there. That was the happy moment in our life. Because my mother was taking it very hard. She was, the first time I heard her, she was, that she was irrational. She was saying, where are my daughter, my children? I need my children, where are they? And my father tried to quieten her, you know. It was such a terrible thing. And that was terrible. It was but the reunion was very, very, very heartwarming. You survive, but then you don't know what to do anyway. You'll be alive for a little while longer.
How did you get into the ghetto?
Oh, how did we get into the ghetto? Trying to remember. I don't remember that, you know. It's amazing.
What did you find there?
Jews who never went any... They thought they were selected to survive, and we didn't have anything to eat, nothing to eat. And but then the partisans started to organize, and there were some Jews already from my hometown that were in the woods. And my father got very tired, and he didn't want to go anymore. He didn't want to run anymore. But I didn't want to go into the ghetto. I didn't want to stay in the ghetto. And I told him, we have to go. So we went, we left the ghetto for the woods.
How long were you in the ghetto?
Maybe a couple months.
What did you do while you were there?
We worked.
What kind of work?
Trying to remember. I don't remember what actually what we did, but I assume we must have been working because it was a war camp. Build roads or something like that. Heavy labor.
Were your sisters working also?
No, the sisters, they left for the woods very soon. Because they were fitting in better then. The woods was a place where you had to be young, strong, and that's it. So you could. And my sisters could fit in better than me or my parents. My parents were too old. But we were there.
When did you leave Doritz?
The date, I don't know the exact date. But it was a matter of a couple months, 2-3 months.
How did you get out?
Did we get out? From then on, they already had people coming from the woods and guide us. So other people that could take you to the woods.
Did anyone else leave with you?
Yeah, the whole group left.
How many people were in the group?
I don't know exactly how many people, but it must have been at least more than 10, 15 people.
And how did you find out about the scouts?
Somehow there was, we knew about that. We knew about that. And it wasn't difficult to get out. It wasn't difficult to get out. And I remember when we came in the woods were close by. So we knew about that, and we left, and we came to the woods. And I remember seeing people in the woods, and I recognized them because they were from Shetland. I couldn't believe it. I kissed the ground because there was no ghetto anymore. No fences. And the woods, it wasn't easy. It was the only place you could go, but it was very cold.
What was the season?
The season was about winter, during the winter. And then the Germans decided that year they're going to wipe out all the partisans. And they get a couple divisions from the front, and they were going through the woods to find them.
What were the woods?
Pardon me?
What was the name of the forest there?
Lubichanskaya Pushcha.
How many people were in that camp?
In the camp? Where we were, it was more like a family camp. We didn't have any weapons, we were totally exposed. Maybe about 20, 25, 30, I don't know how many, 40 people.
How did you get your food?
By begging. I used to go in with my father at night to a village and knock on the window. And see ask for food. So we used to bring some food for my mother, for my my two sisters were in the fighting group because they were a little older.
What was the fighting group? Was it the same unit?
Well, the fighting they used to. My sister was involved in one dynamiting a railroad.
And which sister?
Sarah. And it was basically what they did. The biggest problem was the weapons. We didn't have any ammunition, we didn't have any weapons. And if you didn't have any weapons, you couldn't find them in a partisan group. Because there were no Jewish partisan groups, very few. And without weapons, you were useless.
The fighting unit that your sisters were in, was there a group leader?
Yeah.
Do you know who it was?
There was Kaplinsky. And people there for a little while. One morning, I happened to be outside. We lived in called Zemlanki. This was half of it was in the ground, and the other half was exposed. So we were there. One morning, I happened to be outside the Zimlanki, and there was a lot of shooting going on. Shooting from every direction. And what happened is they discovered our hiding place, and the police and the Germans. Was shooting, and I ran away. My father happened to be outside also. And we ran for a long time. We linked up with about 5 or 6 people. And then we decided we'll go back and see what's going on. When we went back, I didn't know what happened to my father, my mother, or anybody. When we came back, and on the way, I found my mother's shoe. Hacking in my mother's shoe. So I picked it up and I thought I'll bring it to her. But she was, when we came back, she was already dead. They killed her. I didn't see my mother being dead, but I was told by my father. I found my father. That was a big shock to me. She really saved me, because when we came in the woods, we had the raid, and the German army wanted to wipe out all the partisans. And the raid was, a lot of people there had frostbites, including myself. Because you during the daytime, everything thawed. At night, everything was frozen. And so I got frostbites. It was infected.
Where did you have frostbite?
On my feet. It was literally infected. How my mother cured it, I don't know. It's like with a love and trying to keep it clean, because we didn't have any medication, we didn't have anything. But I guess it wasn't my time. And I got cured. She cured me, and this was in and then it It was really something, you know. And we stayed there. There's Rina. God bless her. You don't know what to say about the words. It was so unreal. But it was a safe place. Then my brother-in-law, who was an officer in the partisan unit, the head of a group, he got connected with my sister. I mean, they lived together. And Nyone Shalupsky. And he was from Novogorek, he was not from Shetel. And there was a different group in Novogorek, partisan group. And one of the group, a Jewish group, was Bielski.
Who was Bielski?
Pardon?
Who was Bielski?
There were three brothers. Tavia and I forgot what's his name. And they said that I'm going to be in a ghetto. And there's the only instance where Jews were saved by Jews. And he organized a group of about 1,200 Jewish people. And they saved 1,200 Jewish people.
So, what was your brother-in-law doing?
Somehow there was anti-Semitism in the camp where the Shetel, the Russian attack, and he was, and the message came that they got to go away. They got to separate from that, because the anti-Semitism is very dangerous, because it will kill you. So they left. He left, and he took my sister with him, and they went to the Bielski group. And then later they sent somebody out to help myself, my father, and my sister, Sarah. And we went to the Bielski group.
When did you go to the Bielski group?
I don't know the exact time, but it was the summer, or maybe fall. 1943, because the raid on our camp, family camp, was in May 1943.
How many people survived the raid?
Most of them survived. They killed about five or six Jewish people. We didn't fight. We just ran away. We didn't have any weapons or anything. And two years made a tremendous difference, because I was too small and I didn't fit into the fighting unit. And that was very difficult to be a family person, and for our families to survive, it was very difficult without being a part of a group. So but Bielski, he was very smart, and he knew how to keep 1,200 Jews, for them not killing each other, is in itself an accomplishment. But he also had the ability, he made the 1,200 Jews useful for the partisan movement. They were craftsmen, a lot of craftsmen, and they were working for the partisans. If they needed boots, we made them boots. If they needed fix the weapons, they could fix the weapons. If they needed tailoring, there were tailors, and it was a useful. So, and that's what kept the tribe growing. I mean, that's what kept the group alive. Because otherwise, the partisans wouldn't tolerate it. First of all, they had about 200 active fighters.
Who did?
Pardon me?
Who had 200 active fighters?
The Bielskis. And they wouldn't let 200 fighters protect 1,000 Jews.
We're going to change tapes. Six with Morris Rosnow. Wanted to you to describe your arrival in the Bielski Atriad. What did you see? Who did you meet?
It was unreal. It was like a island in an ocean. It had all kind of cabins over there, and it was very well organized. Very well organized according to the circumstances. You felt pretty safe. It's the first time I felt like I'm a human being. And what they accomplished is beyond belief. What happened is, when the Jews started to go into the woods, the forest, there was a new situation developed. The Germans were offering rewards or compensation for the Jews bring a Jew to the German authorities, you get money. Because there were no more Jews left, very few Jews left, except the partisans. So it was unsafe to try to join the partisans, because they catch you, and you didn't have any weapons, you didn't have anything to protect yourself, and they'll bring you to the, they'll tell you, they'll bring you, they'll hide them, but in the real, they'll take them to the Germans. So what the partisans did, there was one incident where a rabbi ran away. The rabbi ran away, and he was caught by a farmer or whatever, and they tied him down to a wagon in ropes and pulled him from village to village. He died. So the partisans came, and they knew exactly who did what. And they went to their house and said, why did you do it to a rabbi? What did the rabbi ever do anything to you? He said, I didn't do it, my brother-in-law did it. Blaming from one to another. They went to his brother-in-law and brought him also. And then they said, what did you do? Why did you do it? He says, I didn't do it. So anyway, they read a statement, and they killed both of them.
But which partisans killed them?
This is Bielski. I don't remember. Maybe Bielski partisans or Jewish partisans. From then on, the situation has changed, because the Jewish blood was not free, completely free anymore. And they did it in a couple of places, and news travels fast. So from then on, when they met a Jewish person, it was fine trying to find it. They directed him in the right direction. It worked. And that made it more possible for Jewish runaways to get to the... Tobieski was so unique, he was so unreal. He wanted to have family groups. A family was very difficult to survive within the partisan movement. They didn't want you to be in the partisan movement, and you couldn't be by yourself. But he gathered them. His motto was, I'll save a thousand, I'll rather save one Jew than kill 10 Germans. That was total of foreign thoughts. Revenge, it was not part of his game. He said, I'm here to save Jews and nothing else. I'm not sure you kill Germans, but that's like a byproduct. My primary objective is to save Jews. And that's what he did.
Did you meet him?
Yeah. I don't know if he remembers me. You know, I was a little kid, but I saw him a lot of times. Because we lived right next to each other.
What was your impression of him?
Very, very tall, broad shoulders. He made an impact. You couldn't pass him by. I mean, he was... He represented himself with a long leather coat and a big white horse. He was very presentable.
Did he talk to you?
Maybe he did. Maybe he said, how are you, my little one, something like that. But he's got three brothers. He was like the aristocracy, it was like royalty. They had a lot of power, but they didn't abuse it. Not to my knowledge, they didn't abuse it. But he had a lot of power. They killed one guy because he didn't follow the instructions. The rules were you cannot take anything when they got liberated. You cannot, first of all, you cannot rob any farmer. You can take food, but that's all. You cannot take things. And but there's always some people that think they can get away with it. So when we got liberated, and everybody carried very little or nothing, he had a big wagon with leather. You know. So they told him he cannot take it with him. He was put up a fight. He wouldn't obey. So one of the brothers took out the gun and killed him.
Did you see that?
No, I didn't see it, but it's true. I heard about it, and he carried it to his grave. That he was very upset, very sorry that he did it. It was not needed to do.
When you arrived in the camp, where were you? Who brought you into the camp, and where did you live?
Well, we joined one of the Simlankis.
How did they greet you?
Oh, I don't remember. Nobody brought me flowers or anything. But they said hello, I guess. I don't know. It was nothing that made an impression on me, that a lasting impression. It was not a parade. I didn't get an official greeting, no.
What was the first thing that you were given to do?
Oh, I had to stand guard. And they gave me a rifle, and I had to stand guard.
Had you ever held a rifle before?
No. No, and also, the rifle was taller than me, bigger than me. The Russian rifles are very tall, bigger. And I stood guard, and I also built the Simlanki, the living units.
How old were you at this time?
Well, about 15, I think. But I was, some people 15 are very big. I was actually small. I was concerned about my size. But it worked out somehow.
What was your father given to do?
My father, I don't think he did anything. No, he also built. He also involved in building.
How did you build the Zimlyanki?
Well, we had to dig out some dirt, and then construction, regular construction. We had some. We had some people that were, who knew how to do it. I was helping. And then you cover it up with dirt again, the dirt you dig out, you cover up, put it on the roof, and that's it. You had a stove inside.
What was the stove made out of?
Cast iron. I don't know how they made it. I don't know where they got it from. I can't think of it. But we had a stove, and that was it.
How many Zimlyanki were there?
How many? Oh, there were quite a few. There were maybe about 15, 20.
How many people could be asleep in there?
You only slept in there, so about 20 people. On both sides. It was wide enough. It was not separated by sex or anything like that.
When you were given guard duty, tell us about any training that you received for that. You had to learn how to use the rifle?
Well, yeah, you showed us ears. Pull it out, put the bullet in, and shot it, and then you got to look into the and line it up, and the rest will happen automatically. No, we didn't have an original training. No partisan had any military training.
What was the structure of the guard duty?
The structure, well you had to, you got to watch if someone approach comes, if you hear something, you call out the word prearranged. You say something, and they should know what to say also. And that's what it. I had to call out a couple of times.
What was that like?
It was a little scary, you know, because you don't know who you are talking to. And he had a rifle also. But he was better on his rifle than I am on my rifle. But it worked somehow. And I don't remember where they came.
Who was he?
I don't remember who they were and where they came for. But you had to be hidden, and then call out your word, identification word, and they have to reply a certain way, and if they do, then you let them in.
How many of you were guarding?
I was all by myself.
How many hours would you guard?
About 3 or 4 hours. I was afraid very much. I'm not a hero at heart. So, and then in 19, but life over there was very, very normal, almost normal. I don't remember being hungry. We had food.
Where did the food come from?
The same way, we take it from the farmers. We never took the last horse, and we never took the last cow. But if they had 2 cows, we'll take one. And that's why we had the 200 armed partisans. And they were supplying, they were going out with a wagon and go out for food. They didn't beg. They didn't go to the window and knock on the window ask for bread. They took it.
You had mentioned earlier that there were craftsmen in the Bielskis.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever help them with any of their work?
Well, I was building the Zimlankis. That was my job. But I'm not a craftsman.
Where did the craftsman work?
In one of those buildings we built for them. Some blankets.
Do you remember any of them?
The craftsman? No.
What else was there? Anything else besides the Zimlyanki where you lived and where the craftsmen worked?
What else? What do you mean, what else was there?
Where did the Bielski brothers live?
Oh, they had also Zimlyankis, but it was a little nicer. They had a little nicer setting. The view was the same. I remember that when we got liberated, I was so afraid to get out of the woods. I went through a total transformation. When I came, as a child, I was so afraid of the woods. When the war was over, I was afraid to get out of the woods. The vista was very frightening to me. I didn't feel safe.
What happened in the forest if somebody was ill?
There was a problem. There was a doctor over there, but there was very little medication. But at the end, there was contact with Moscow. There was a regular, they used to take the wounded away to There was a regular transportation. Take the wounded away and bring some medicine, bring some food. Not food, but medicine. And so there was things were getting a lot better. And you felt the Germans were afraid to go into the woods.
Why?
Because of the partisans. They were very much afraid. They wouldn't. If they had to go someplace, they would go on the main road.
How large was the Liposhanskaya Pusha?
I don't know how large it was. It was very big. And there were other pushes also. And there were partisans all over the place. At night was the partisans were on the move. In the daytime, the Germans were on the move. They had partisans around Vilno, they had partisans around Grodno, they had partisans around Bialystok, they had partisans around every area had their own partisan movement. And then they brought in a general from Moscow who unified the whole thing. And then it was clockwork.
What were the sanitary conditions like in the forest?
There was something else. Very bad. Very bad. It was, I don't remember how we kept ourselves clean. But that was one of the priorities. I remember being when I was still sick with my frostbites. And when they had a meeting in our Semlanke one time. And my father literally had to stand in front of me because I couldn't move. I couldn't get up to hold the people back because they would have stampeded on me. Because I couldn't get out, I couldn't get up. I was my feet were bandaged and I don't remember what was the meeting about. But the sanitary conditions were very bad.
Was there any body of water nearby?
No, I don't remember any.
How did you stay warm?
Well, basically, the blanket was keeping you warm. And then there was a little stove kept you warm. I don't remember being cold. And you wear clothes.
What were the clothing that you had?
I don't remember being cold, so I must have had good clothes. I think maybe a sweater, or I don't remember having a sweater either.
Do you remember the shoes you had?
Regular shoes? I don't know. Boots were very good, helpful. But I don't think I had boots. Maybe I did.
Where were your sisters during this time?
They were also... Myra was together with Norman. Mira was together with her husband. But Sarah was with us. Myself, Sarah, and my father.
Was Sarah in the same Zimlyanka?
Yeah.
Was everybody given the same types of tasks? Or did men and women have different tasks from one another?
I remember one night we were lying in the Zimlyanka and sleeping. Or going to sleep or something, and one woman stuck out a leg like this and said, "How beautiful my leg is." You know, with all that's going on around you, you know, something like this happening. It was funny. Well, you know, people living together for so long.
Did you make friends there?
Pardon me?
Did you make friends in the Bielski partisans?
No, I didn't.
Why not?
I don't know. No, I don't remember. Well, there's acquaintances. We met some people there, but I don't remember being friends.
How did people deal with the small quarters?
Small quarters?
How were people's relations among one another with, under the circumstances in which you were living?
Well, we had a common enemy or whatever, I don't know, but we didn't kill each other. But it wasn't love either. But it was. Oh, you got the defiance, didn't you? I mean, that tells you pretty much what's happening.
I mean, I'm curious about your perspective.
Oh.
You were 15 years old? Were there ever any arguments with other boys?
With other 15-year-olds? I don't think there were too many 15-year-olds over there. It wasn't a normal society, you know. It was remnants from here and there that got together. But it wasn't you would think it would be 15-year-olds and 16-year-olds and 7-year-olds. But it wasn't like that. Because there were people gathered from one left here, one left here, one left there. It was not a normal a normal system, a normal formation of age.
Were there any religious Jews living in the forest?
I would think there must have been. I don't know how. I don't know how they lived. There may have been a synagogue. I'm not sure. I didn't look for one.
Did you celebrate any Jewish holidays?
In the forest? I don't remember any.
Do you remember any festivities?
It was more on the Russian system, not Jewish system. It was more on the Russian holidays, communist holidays.
What were some of those holidays?
Maybe the 1st of May, or Stalin's birthday, or Stalin's... I think the 1st of May was a big holiday.
What did you do?
Well, I think they had a parade. Even.
A parade?
Yeah. I think so. Trying to remember. We were walking, you know.
Was Tuvia Bielski a communist?
He must, well, I don't think, according to the book, I didn't see it was a communist, but he had to deal with under the Russian system. But I don't know if he was a communist.
Were there ever any gatherings of people just with small groups of people that...
Special social evening together? I don't know, I don't remember any. We were not out of the woods yet. So I don't know. And who could celebrate?
Were you very conscious of the level of noise that you made in the forest?
No. No, we were pretty free. I mean, as far as that goes, we didn't have to be very quiet or anything like that. We had a fire going all the time. The Canaanite.
How was your father's health during this time?
He wasn't sick. Maybe the woods in itself helped him. He got sick after, I wasn't there, but he got sick after we came out of the woods. He may have gotten some cancer or something, I don't know. I wasn't there. I was already in Poland.
Were there any romances in the woods?
Oh, yeah.
Did your sister have a romantic interest, or
my,
you?
My younger sister? Hmm? No, she was the only one, maybe, that held out completely. She didn't want to get involved with anybody. She's a pretty strong person.
We're going to change tapes. This is cassette 7 with Morris Rosnow.
I'm going to play a song that's called The Partisan Hymn. I haven't played for a long time, so you'll have to forgive me if it's not a professional melody.
Lyrics to that song?
Yeah.
Do you know the lyrics?
Das Morgenwald. Okay. Sag nicht geh mal aus der Gäste im letzten Weg. Hat Schimmel im Leien, er verstellen blöde Tag. Komm, er wird nach unser ausgebänkte Schor. Es wird erpulkt in unser Tod mit seinen Dor. Von grünen Palmen an bis Land von weißem Schnee. Mit seinen Dor, mit unser Pei, mit unser Wei. Und wo gefallen ist der Sprotz von unser Blut. Sport so wird noch unser Gewur und der Mut. Der Frühmorgen wird vergehen noch mit der Heind. Und der Nächten wird verschwinden mit der Feind. Und wo, oh ja, und wo gefallen Sport von unser Blut? Sport so wird noch unser Gewur und der Mut. Das ist geschrieben mit Blut und nicht mit Blei. Das ist kein Lied von Erfolg oder frei. Das hat Erfolg zwischen Frau und ich gewähnt. Das Lied gesungen mit einer Garnis in der Hand. Das ist nicht kämmel, als die Gäste im letzten Weg. Hat sie ihm noch bleiene, verstellen, blöde Tag. Komm, er wird noch unser Haus gebänkt, der Show. Es wird der Brücke und der Tod nur seine da.
What is it about?
It tells you not to never say that you are going the last walk. Even though the blue, you cannot see in the blue sky, it's all covered with gray. Our day will still come, and we'll be banged on the street that we are here. The song was not written with, it was written with blood and not with lead. This is kind of, it's not a song from a free bird. Bird in the free. It's a song zwischen Frauen, between four crumbling walls. It was singing, and people were singing with naganas, with weapons in their hands. Basically, it's a don't give up.
When did you sing this song?
I sing it every year during Shoah. And I'll sing it in a couple days when we have the Shoah. This is my participation in it.
When did you sing it while you were in the Bielski Partisans?
No, I didn't. I don't think so. I don't remember it from there. But we did sing it, because I do remember it. I don't think about it every day, but I think you...
Are there any other songs that you sang at that time?
Jeden Tag. That's a ghetto song. Jeden Tag, jeden Tag, jeden Free, jeden Tag, na 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 na. Und I gotta remember it. Und wenn meine Welt, na 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 na. I can't remember the words. The Partisan song, I know it because I'm singing every year.
Is there anything else about the partisan life that you'd like to talk about?
In my hometown, the only people survived that were the partisans. No other people survived. It's a real only part. If somebody says they survived in my hometown, they had to be with the partisans. Because there was no other chance. Maybe a couple people here and there could hide themselves with a farmer. But basically, that's the only way out. The partisans did the. It was with when the ghetto was starting organizing the partisan movement, resistance movement, and trying to get weapons. One Jewish person, got in contact with a Russian officer, and he said, "Well, give him. He has a rifle or a gun." And the Russian officer was going to give him a gun for money. He went. They had a meeting place. He went to the meeting place. A Jewish person, and he was one of the group around Alto Dvoretsky that in the ghetto, and. When they came to an appointed place, the Germans arrested them. They were betrayed. And then he was held in a jail cell, right not too far from the ghetto. And he used to throw out messages written with his own blood. I didn't say anything. I'm not going to reveal anybody. Please, revenge for me.
Which ghetto was he in?
In Jethel.
What was his name? Do you remember his name?
I can't remember his name. The reason it's so difficult to remember, because they brought Jews from outside area in the Jethel ghetto that never lived in Jethel.
What happened to him?
He got killed. But he never revealed anything. There was a lot of God takes a lot of power, a lot of willpower, a lot of guts to do it, you know? Mm. Oh, you want to play a little bit?
No, I'll put it here.
Oh, thank you.
Tell me about when liberation came to the forest. What do you remember?
I remember we had a long walk. We went to Jethel.
And when was it?
No. I went to Novogurek. That was the middle 1944, because that's when this area was liberated by the Russian army. And I remember the commotion in the group, in the partisan group, that all kinds of rumors came about. People got so used to the partisan group that some people said that Bielski is going to go farther to Poland and organize another partisan group. You know? But that didn't happen. And we were walking and walking and walking. I don't think I was so jubilant, you know? I don't know. Maybe I was numb. So many things happened and I couldn't, it wasn't a very happy moment.
Why not?
Well, so many people got killed. I survived, but so many others got killed. And we had a close-knit society in Jethel, Jewish people. And when we came back, there wasn't, you saw the houses. People looked out of the houses, were not Jews. And they hated you. They were afraid that you're coming to take their house away. It's not their house to start with. So some people got killed after the war. The Polacks.
What did the town look like when you got back there?
The town looked about the same because there was no fighting going on.
Were you able to get your apartment?
No. My apartment was in Jethel. We came to Novogurek. Bielski came to Novogurek. So we moved in a house which belonged to my brother-in-law, so their family over there. And we stayed there for a little while. And then we went to Lodz in Poland. And from Lodz in Poland, we went to a displaced person camp on the American zone in Germany, Austria, Germany.
How long were you there?
Till I came to the States. I took out a couple years and went to school. I went to a German university in Munich. And the reason how I got to school is there were a lot of young men of my age who never had a high school education. So we had to pass a test, take a 6 weeks concentrated course in and if you pass a test of the material you studied, then you can you get they'll accept you to a German university, and that's what I did.
Did you go back to Jeddah at all after the war?
Yeah.
For how long?
For a few days here and there.
And what? Where was your father?
He was also in Novogurek until he died.
When did he die?
1945 or 1946. I wasn't there.
And where did your sisters go?
The younger sister stayed with my father. And my older sister, she was with her husband. It wasn't very easy then because there was not enough food. And in 1949, I got my visa for the United States, and I emigrated. I came to the United States in 1950, January 1950.
Where did you arrive?
I arrived in New York, one of the last of the Ellis Islands. And then it was in Baltimore. I came to Baltimore somehow. Oh yeah, I'm in New York, and my uncle met me in New York, and we went to Baltimore because that's where they lived.
Which uncle?
My father's brother. His name was Isaac. Erwin.
Erwin?
He had two uncles and he had two brothers and a sister in the United States, my father.
What was your impression of New York?
Well, the first place he took me was an automat. You know, when you put a quarter in, a sandwich comes out, or whatever. Well, it was so big. It looks a lot different than Bielski. I don't know, I was already in Germany, but then about three or four years. So it wasn't a shock right away. But I remember when we came in New York, we came from Bremerhaven by a boat. General Heinzelmann is the name of the boat. And I was so hungry. They didn't give us anything to eat. We were already on our way to America, but somehow they didn't give us anything to eat until we got on the ship. And then there was food you could in abundance, with the American habit of everything has to be in abundance. But we did. So I was very welcome to the food. Was very welcome to me. My sister was so afraid that she'd get seasick. We came together, my Sarah, that she got seasick even before we left the port. She was thinking so much about it, so she couldn't. The food was no importance to her. For me, I was super hungry. So we got food, and then we came to Baltimore to see my uncle, my aunt. They were very much surprised that we were the only children survived. And Chacham came, my other uncle, and nobody survived. They couldn't understand why. How can you understand? How can you explain something like that? So you keep your mouth shut and you don't talk about it. What can you do? Until you realize that if you're not going to talk about it, who will? So you talk about it. That's why that's when I started to talk about it. But the beginning was very difficult.
What made it difficult?
You think people won't understand, they won't believe you even. Because my aunt, people over there, so they had it bad also, because they couldn't buy a car, they couldn't buy, they were rationed during the war. And you tell them that, anyway, they thought, so it was, then after, okay, going back to my process of continuation. So I was in Baltimore, and then I came to California, because my sisters were already in California. My brother-in-law, from the Vigurek, he had his family was in San Francisco, so he wanted to go to San Francisco. So my sister went, and so my other sister went. So Morris went, like one chain.
What did you do when you got to California?
I came on a Monday, and I got a job on Thursday.
What were you doing?
I was working in a warehouse, and the guy that was working there normally, he went on vacation for 2 weeks. By the time he came back, they wouldn't hire him, they kept me. I guess I must have made a good impression.
What were you doing?
Well, packing and delivering, and it was nothing specialized. Anybody could do that, what I did.
How long had it been since you'd been in the States when you moved to California?
I moved to California in, let's see, 1950, I think, 1950.
How did you communicate? Were you able to?
I could make myself understood. I knew a little English. No, not before, but I learned a little English. Mm-hmm. I was young, you know, young, and you learn a lot of things a lot faster. But English was not a problem. Actually, in 1952, I was already in college. After 2 years, I enrolled to University, to City College, and from there, I ended up in the University of California. Mm-hmm. And I graduated in pharmacy. And that's what I did all my productive life.
And when did you meet your wife?
We met in 1960, we got married in 1962. So we knew each other because it's a small community. And she used to go to the Jewish functions, singles, and I used to go to the Jewish singles. But we didn't start dating until about 1961. I met her after I'd been in the States already, I graduated in 1956, and then we got married in 62. We didn't court each other very long. I was already getting to be 35, and Gina was getting to be approaching the 30 level, and she couldn't be single at age 30. That's what she told herself. So we got married. And we've lived in this area, San Francisco. She worked at the time in San Mateo. And I worked in San Francisco. So we moved to Burlingame.
And did you have children?
Yeah, we have three children. two boys and a girl.
Did you talk to your children about your experiences?
Not that much. They know a little bit, but I think you know more than they do. It's not, you know, somehow you have this idiosyncrasies, you feel like you don't want to burden the children, you're afraid it'll ruin them, it'll ruin their relationship with people or whatever. But so we didn't talk too much about it. Here a little bit there, but not in chronological order.
What about with Gina?
Gina knows more than the kids, but she doesn't know too much the whole thing either. It was hard to talk about it.
Do you think back on the Holocaust very often?
Yeah. More often now than before. When I was working, I was very busy, and I didn't have the time to think. But now I have more time, and I think a lot more about it.
Do you ever have nightmares?
No.
Did you, the beginning?
No. Nothing that would make an impact on me, because I don't remember it. But I may have had nightmares which I don't remember. Actually, after the wars, we found out the exact what happened, the Holocaust. We didn't know anything about it. The concentration camps, the ovens, I didn't know a thing about it.
Is there anything that I haven't asked you that you want?
You were pretty thorough. I hope my doctor is as good as you are.
Is there a message you'd like to say for future generations about your experiences?
I think it's good that you are doing it. I think it's good that because the Holocaust. Something that came to my mind I want to share with you. I was thinking about Bielski. To me, Bielski was in the woods. He was like Israel today is in the world. The Jews have one small place, because Israel is a very small country, but they are welcome. And that was in the woods, Bielski. There was one place where Jews were welcome. And somehow it came to my idea that I related it with Israel. I feel very strongly about Israel. There's one place in the world where Jews are welcome. You don't have to apologize for being Jewish. And that's what Bielski was in the partisans. When there was an argument or a fight come between a Jewish person and Jewish partisan and a Russian partisan, the Jewish partisan has a place to go. The Russian partisan has a lot of places to go. One place he could go was Bielski. And they'll take him in, and unless he committed a crime. And that's what Bielski accomplished.
Thank you for giving your testimony.
Thank you.
Rosnow, would you like to introduce your family?
I'll be very happy to. To my right is my lovely wife, Gina Einstein Rosnow. Right? Right.
Yes.
Now, I gotta turn around to see who's behind me. Oh, to my right is David Samuel Rosnow, my son, my youngest son. And next to him is My daughter-in-law, Yuriko Sugihara Rosnow, and she's holding my youngest grandchild, Rina Sugihara Rosnow.
Yeah.
And next to her is my oldest son, Harley
Michael
Rosnow.
And Michael Rosnow.
What's your name?
Harley Rosnow.
Ah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Harley Rosnow.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Next to Harley Rosnow, I was corrected by my grandson. Kinori Sugihara Rosnow. And next to Kinori must be Heather.
Heather
Einstein Rosnow. And that's the extent of my family. I have some sisters, but you don't want to get into that.
Mrs. Rosnow, I had asked your husband earlier how you met, and I was wondering if I could hear your version of the story.
Oh my God. Well, okay. We met in San Francisco at various singles functions, and we used to go single functions where dancing was involved. We used to like to dance, and we each went there separately and left separately, but we were in a group of young people who would join dance activities. And one time I had lost all my identity cards, and I decided that since I didn't have any identity anyhow, I would cut off my long hair. I had very long hair that I could almost sit on, and I either braided it or I had it kind of on a dut. And so I came to dance after I'd cut my hair, and Morse kind of looked at me, and I said, "Don't you recognize me? It's me, Gina." And so that evening, he invited me out for a cup of coffee, and I went, and that was the beginning of the end, or the beginning of the beginning.
Did he speak to you about his experiences in the partisans during the war?
He didn't speak about that for many years. I knew that Morse was a survivor, but for many, many years, Morse didn't talk. hardly at all, did not talk about his experiences, and only later, as I noticed that other people were starting to talk about their experiences, did Morris start talking himself. I knew that there was a certain part of his life that he just, that I don't know about. And I just, I knew that's how it is, you know. But then slowly he started talking about. It wasn't, it just was. You know, it was, that's, you know, I felt that it was good that he started to talk about it. And then also his sisters and he started talking about things here and there. And it helped understand things. It was kind of, in some areas, he was completely, like, closed off to me. But we had a separate life, sort of like our own life, that didn't include that for a long time.
Did Morris talk to, did Mr. Rosnow speak with you children about his experiences then?
Yeah, I remember. I can't remember exactly, but I remember it was a Friday night after we had Shabbat dinner one night, and for some reason my dad said, I want you to all come into the family room. I mean, into the living room, into the room in here. And he began to tell us part of his story. Do you guys remember that?
How old were you?
I don't remember how old I was, but I remember sitting in the yellow chair over here and Dad sitting on the couch, and I don't remember exactly. I can just picture kind of what was going on. I don't remember how old I was. We were probably fairly young. Like in, I think I was fairly young, probably at least sixth grade. That's all I remember.
Okay, sixth grade
or something. Maybe even a little younger. Do you remember?
No.
No, I don't remember that. I remember that my dad, I always felt like Dad was talking to other people about it and explaining about it more than ever. I had heard like a complete recitation of the whole story. Although after a while we did all sit down and get to hear it. A lot of it was new to me, but other parts of it were familiar.
You're tired.
Yeah.
Do you think it has any effect on the way that you are bringing up your children?
I'm sure it will. I'm sure it does. I think the whole experience has given my dad, has made certain things very important to my father, like the environment that he creates for his family and his ability to provide for them. And I remember that he never wanted his children to be hungry, and things like that sort of definitely echo in our family too.
Flashlight.
Canary, you have to be quiet when I'm speaking.
Flashlight.
No, you can't have the flashlight right now. No, you have to be. You said you were going to be good.
I want to be good.
You want to be good? Okay, so let's be quiet. Let me hold you. And, I feel like the environment that I create for my family is very important for me. So, I think that with my dad, once he settled on pharmacy as being a good, stable sort of source of income, that was what was important to him, and then the rest was invested in his family. But for me, I think that not having gone through the kind of experience that he has, picking what I wanted to do in my career and things like that were much more of a a hard decision and struggle. I think all three of us had many more opportunities to, and yet choices that we had to make, whereas my dad had just one, like, to survive. So those are sort of the big the big impacts. What's important, and I think that as a result of his experience and the way it's what I've learned of it, and the way he raised us, I think that family is very important to us, or to me.
I don't remember a time when if I asked Dad a question that he wouldn't answer it. I think he was very open about, at least by the time that I was maturing enough to have curiosity about it, he was open to answer the questions that we had. And I think also I had the same experience that a lot of times we would hear a lot more of the story in different contexts other than, you know, the questions that we might have if we went to watch him speak to a class, or if we were in a situation where he was talking to somebody else about it. Sometimes things would occur, you know, that might not come up around the dinner table.
Yeah, I feel the same way. Just I learned a majority of the story by hearing my father speak at schools. And I think he also spoke at the synagogue before and in different places. And that's where I did learn the majority of the story. And it didn't seem... It's so hard for me to grasp that my father was in the Holocaust, you know? It just never really seemed real. Because living here and the way we live, I just have never been able to fathom what he went through, and I hear it and it still affects me every time, and I can't always go and see things regarding the Holocaust a lot. I mean, I'll go and then I don't go back. And I remember when in United Synagogue, when I was in my youth group, we were at a convention, an international convention, and we saw the movie The Exodus, and that movie for some reason triggered something in me. But I remember after seeing that movie, I was extremely upset that whole evening, and I remember calling home and telling them about it.
I think it's also difficult for us to know what impact something like that has on our parents and on us, because for one thing, like, both of our parents are immigrants, so that seems to have an effect on people to begin with, whether or not they've had this sort of experience. And it's just difficult to know how someone is affected by that when, you know, I only know my parents as they're in their adult lives providing for me, and, you know, being my parents and how they relate to other people. Mm-hmm. And also they're from very different cultures than what I know. Looking at other adults from American society, I don't know whether how they relate to other people that I perceive as different is an outgrowth of the Holocaust experience or growing up in you know, the shtetl type of environment or the whole coming to America. I don't know how things interplay. I know that from my parents, like, the priorities were definitely on, I mean, especially for my father, and the priorities were on providing for us and seeing our education and secure and doing whatever he could do to secure our future and those sort of things. And I mean, I know that was a big priority.
I think that in a way, Morris and I have grown up in a very different... We are both Jewish, but we are from different backgrounds. because I'm from a German Jewish background and I grew up in Israel. And my parents' standard of living or way of life was very different in Europe before we went to Israel. And in fact, when I told my parents about Morris, they felt, gee, are you going to marry a Polish Jew? You know, it's sort of like discrimination from a German Jew against a Polish Jew. But I guess I told them, yes, I would. And what made me kind of sad is that at one point they had a party and still introduced me to other single people trying to, you know, sidetrack me. But I think in Morris I found a warmth that was different than what I experienced in our family. I think, you know, quote, culturally being exposed to art, music, and those type of things. I had a maybe more knowledgeable background, but the people type caring or feeling qualities that I perceived in Morris were not quite as available in our family. And I think that is one of the reasons, you know, I wasn't dissuaded. But I also feel that being that I had a different life experience and I didn't go through the Holocaust, that most of our children had a different emotional upbringing than if both of us were survivors. And I have met children of couples where both of them were survivors, and as many challenges or problems that our kids may have, I think they have a better balance or a healthier balance, because Morris and I have different attitude and we kind of balance each other in some ways, I feel.
I just got to interject something, that my balance is not so good.
That's your physical balance now. I'm talking about emotional.
Okay.
But I always loved your sense of humor.
Is there anything, Mr. Rosnow, that you'd like to say when your family's off here?
Oh, it was very interesting for me to listen to it. I learned a lot about how you feel and how you, what you think. That's great. I think you grew up very well. We, our effort and our dedication did worked out well. I'm thankful for that.
Okay. Well, one thing that, as David said, that it's very important for us to have our education and we get to pursue the things that we really enjoy. My parents have been helping me a lot lately to pursue one of my passions is singing opera, so we thought we'd end by singing a song. And this is from La Gioconda. It's called Voce di Donna.
Voce di donna, donna. senza pietosa donna.
What I want to say is, sorry, no, that's not what I want to say. I would like to say that I'm really glad that Yoriko is such a wonderful mother to our grandchildren, and I think that Harley and Yoriko are a really a good couple together, and I just felt like it should be said now.
So gotta come back now.
Come on back.
And also that I know that when they got married, they've told me since that at one point I was crying and I thought, and they asked me how come, and so I guess I must have said that I'm sad that we wouldn't have Jewish grandchildren to continue the Rosnow name, but the kids are Jewish and they are turning out to be wonderful little people, and I think that is great. And I hope that if Heather and David find somebody nice, that they get married too. So, but I'm not pushing, they should find the right person. Anyhow, thank you, Yuri.
Thank you.
Yeah, we are now actually looking at some pictures from Zettel. The book is called Pinchas Zettel, which was published in Israel to the 50th anniversary of the liquidation of the community. And uh, My mother is the lady, the third lady on, my, on the left-hand side of the photograph. And this photograph was taken on the 1919, and it's, we're collecting money for the for the children's kitchen after the First World War, 1919.
Do you remember any of the other women's names in the photograph?
I know them, but I don't remember their names. Okay, this is a picture of my father. Is one of the gentlemen in the picture. He's the standing in the standing row on the left hand side, not the first one.
And what
for the mustache?
Who are all the other gentlemen? What is this photograph taken for?
The photograph was taken for a commerce meeting. Tradesman committee, and.
Okay, great.
Yeah, those are houses on the street which I lived on, and the houses look so little to me and so dilapidated, but I don't remember it being that way. And but I guess when you look at it, you don't see it when you look at it continuously.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, this is a picture of some woman from Zhetel, and one of them is my aunt, my father's sister, and she's the lady in the front sitting on the second lady on the right with the braids.
And what year was this taken?
1918. Yeah, this is a. The Zhetel survivors in the
memorial. It is
anyway. This is the sixth anniversary of the annihilation of the Jews in Zhetel, and. That was taken in 1948. This is what's left of the memorial.
We'll show that one next, okay. In a different shot. Okay.
Yeah, this is a picture of the memorial in my hometown in Zhetel, and the people that came for a visit are friends of mine. I know them. The gentleman in the green shirt with a hat is the only Jewish person living in Zhetel today. And his name is Avremel Kaplan.
Mm. Okay.
This is a picture of my parents, Hanarashke Rasnov, went to her left is Chaim Michal Rasnov.
What year was this photo taken in, do you know?
I don't know what year it was taken, but I did it. I combined two pictures, separate pictures.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a picture of my family as it was before the Second World War. And from the left to right is my sister Mira, myself, my father Chaim Michal, my mother Hanna Rashke, my grandmother Henya Rabinovich, and the little girl in front is Sarah Rasnov, my sister.
Thank you.